Let us celebrate what is good. Let us shout about what is good. Let us sing about what is good. Let us make music about what is good. And what is it that is good? It's you. In Psalm 139, verses 14 to 16, the Bible tells me, I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to be here present with your other children. We thank you for the first part of this morning's meeting. We thank you for your spirit that flowed. We thank you for your anointing that abide upon your people. Heavenly Father, as we come before the throne to listen to you, we pray that you speak to us, Lord. You minister into our lives and into our situations. Heavenly Father, as you minister to us, Father, we pray that we will be people willing to receive from you, to be changed by you, to be molded by you for the kingdom, as we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Sing for joy to God our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Begin the music. Strike the tambourine. Play the melodious harp and lyre. Sound the ram's horn at the new moon. And when the moon is full, on the day of our feast, this is a decree of Israel, an ordinance of God of Jacob. Sing. I believe that the word sing is universal. Sing a song. I'm sure if a band strikes up here this morning and starts to play YMCA, everyone will be up YMCA. Sing for joy to our God, our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Sometimes, us Christians tend to feel that it is wrong to worship God. And when we pray to God, we just keep quiet. When we worship God, we don't want to show our emotion. But here, the Bible says, sing and shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Begin the music, strike the tambourine. I dare say that in every culture, every language, every tribe, singing is acceptable. Actually, I don't think there's any culture where singing is not acceptable, where dancing is not acceptable, where playing musical instrument is not acceptable. Well, someone is saying here Afghanistan, but I think that was just a band of people saying other people must not enjoy. But as children of God, when we say sing and shout and begin music, you sit back and think, why should I sing? I am in this situation, I'm in this circumstance that makes my situation dire. The last thing I want to do is sing. The last thing I want to do is dance. The last thing I want to do is play instrument. But in the Bible, there's no qualification as to when you sing, as to when we should shout, as to when you begin the music. He just says, sing for joy to God our strength and shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Begin the music. It doesn't say begin the music only when you are happy. It doesn't say begin the music only when you've got a new job. It doesn't say begin the music when you are in a stable relationship, there's no worry in the world. It says, begin the music. Strike the tambourine, play the melodious harp and lyre. Sound the ram's horn at new moon. God told the children of Israel to worship him at the beginning of each month. And for us, I'm saying, I just said this morning that it's not just at the beginning of each month when our pay packets or our salaries are paid into our banks, but every second, every minute, every day of our life, we need to be in his presence, worshiping and praising him. Why? I'm going to read from Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning, God created heavens and earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. At the beginning, the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. This morning, it may be that you look at your life and you think it is worthless. You look at your situation and you think it is hopeless. You look at this world, you think there's no chance. Although the earth was without form, but God, a writer says, is giving it form. He's changing it. He's molding it. Actually, he's remolding it. And maybe, and I believe that this morning, God is at work in your life. There's a move of God, there's a move of his power and his authority and his anointing upon his people. And he's at work in your life. The deep is covered in darkness, but God will command the light. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Wow. That was power. That was authority. Just like that, God says, let there be light, and there was light. So if God can speak to the elements and they obey him, why do you think God cannot speak into your situations and to your circumstances? God called the light day, and darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, let there be an expanse between waters to separate water from water. So God made the expanse and separated water under the expanse from the water above it. And it was so. God called the expanse sky. And there was evening, and there was morning. He separated light from darkness, separated water from water, created the space for vegetations and creatures. And God said, let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear, and it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw it. It was good. Then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds. And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seeds according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the third day. And God said, let there be light in the expanse of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let them serve as signs to mark seasons and days and years. And let them be lights in this expanse of the sky to give light on the earth. And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the sky. So God created the great creatures of the sea, and every living and moving thing with which the water teems according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and increase in number, and fill the water in the seas, and let the birds increase on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, livestock creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to his kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our own image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth. Every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food. And to all beasts of the earth, and all the birds of the air, and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has breath in it, I give every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. God is good. So he separated light from darkness, separated water from water, created space for vegetations and creatures. He made animals, he made birds. And he crowned it with man. Job 26 says, "He spreads out the northern skies over empty space. He suspends the earth over nothing." I have wondered at times, especially when I was still young. I'm still young anyway. How that expanse stays there. Can anyone tell me how he stays there? How the seas are bounded together and they keep their course? How everything is in order? I wonder. In Job, he says, "He wraps up the water in his clouds, yet the clouds do not burst under their weight." Amazing. "He covers the face of the full moon, spreading his clouds over it. He marks out the horizon on the face of waters for a boundary between light and darkness." Our God is amazing. So if God can do that to the elements, if God by his words can make things happen, if God by his power can separate land, can put water to one side, if God can make the sky stand up there, what else am I looking for? Why can't I turn to him? Why can't I turn to him? But the beautiful thing is, out of that formless thing comes beauty, comes newness, comes what God looked at and said it was good. For us who are children of God, things rings true. In that, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, and the new has come." So just as the formless world, the formless earth, was made by man, was put in order by God, so we are new creation in him. When we come before him and accept him as our Lord and as our Savior, we are new people. And it may be this morning that someone here is staying. "I don't know where I am. I don't know who I am. I don't know my situation. I don't even know if there's a God." I tell you, there is a God, our Lord Jesus Christ. "For we were in sin, without hope, being prepared for judgment by the redemptive power of the blood of the Lamb, performed the miracle. It is a miracle that Jesus Christ would die for me, that he would die for you. Even if you are the last person on earth, he would still have gone to the cross for you. That's how much he cares for you. That's how much he loves you. It is a miracle. I am a miracle. And you are miracles. When we look at verse 2, part of verse 2, it says, the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. The work of the Spirit through the Word brings life when there's no life. Bring possibilities of growth and fulfillment where before there was only waste. Look at it. Imagine it without form. But it brought order by His Spirit. And look at your own situation. Look at your own life. Look at where you've come from. In sin, we were born. We were not worthy of being called His children. We were not worthy of anything. But because of the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, by His Spirit, we are saved. We are saved. And one of the songs we sang this morning just spoke to me powerfully. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, and my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm from the fiercest drought and storm, what height of love, what depths of peace. When fear are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. His Spirit is at work in you, in us, always. The miracle is that by His power we are saved. By His power we are redeemed. Just out of this formless earth, He created a beauty. That's very good. So out of our sinful body, He created people that are new, that are called unto Him. He created people. He created you. He created me. He redeemed us. And I've said it quite a lot of time, that sometimes we don't appreciate the gift of God to us. We still believe every day that we are not worthy, but I tell you, brothers and sisters, that you are more than worthy. You need to exhibit the kingdom of God in your day-to-day life. You walk like a king. You walk like the child of the kingdom. You walk like the heir to the kingdom. Imagine for one second that let's say I'm not here at this present moment, and I walk in there, everyone would just look, it's Timmy. But let's imagine again that through that door walks in Prince Charles. I'm sure when some of us shake him, we'll go home and put a wrapping paper around that hand. I'll not use that hand to eat anymore. I'll use my left hand. What I'm trying to say is, I hope you understand the logic, that as children of the kingdom, we need to exhibit the characteristics of the children of the kingdom. You need to take hold of your possession. And when I say taking hold of your possession, I'm not just talking about the material possession. I'm not just talking about the money in the bank or the building that covers your head. I'm talking about the authority that is in you. You need to exhibit it. I'm talking about God's grace that is upon your life. You need to show it. I'm talking about God's power and authority that radiates through you. The Spirit of God lives in you, abides in you, walks with you, and you need to exhibit it. When you see some pop star, they tell you, just imagine, Greenford is going to host, who is the biggest pop star now? Anyone. Yeah, let's say Madonna, okay? Greenford is going to host Madonna. And he's going to be staying at that hotel on the Greenford roundabout. The bridge, yeah, that's right. I can tell you there will be people staying there overnight just to have a glimpse of him. Of her, sorry. I don't know anything about her to suggest she's now a he. There'll be people out there waiting to have a glimpse of him. Oh! The Spirit in you needs to be alive in you. And when it is alive in you, we are all powerful. Because God is with you and God is in you. John 3:6 says, flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. We need to. It's interesting, I didn't see David's program this morning. So it's not as if we've sat down during the week to say, I needed to read this part. But the Spirit of God gives birth to spirit. And we need to realize that. We need to hold on to that. And we need to live that. We need to live that. In verse 31, God looked at what he had created. And he said, it was very good. Very, very good. So rather than concentrate on what is bad, Let us look at what is good. Let us celebrate what is good. Let us shout about what is good. Let us sing about what is good. Let us make music about what is good. And what is it that is good? It's you. It is you. In Psalm 139, verses 14 to 16. The Bible tells me, I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. You are good. Indeed, you are very good. Because you have been wonderfully made. And when you say something has been wonderfully made, it means that thing is unique. Look past this color. It's nothing. It is unique. It is set apart. It is marvelous. Say to this person sitting next to you, I am unique. Because you are unique. You are made in God's image. You are made in God's... Because the Bible tells me, God said, let us make man in our own image. And I'm not a scientist, but you see people that are born as twins, identical twins. You see them, you can't tell them apart. But each of them is still unique. And each of us present here this morning, we are unique. The Bible says, before you were born, he knows you, he cares for you. Whatever you have been or are, he still cares. And John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever... It doesn't say, if Timmy alone believes. It doesn't say, if Ola believes. It doesn't say, if John believes. It doesn't say, if Margarita believes. It says, whosoever believes. For God so loved the world. He loves you. He loves me. That whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. What a promise. What a powerful promise. So, I believe, therefore, that I am right in saying that every time there's room to dance, there's room for singing, there's room for shouting for God's joy in our life. Every day, everywhere, under every situation and circumstance, there's room for it. David Atkinson wrote that we need to reflect on God's transcendent freedom to bring into being what he wills, to bring form out of what is formless, to give order where there's disorder, shape and pattern and beauty to what is as yet a waste. That's our God. That is our God. As we journey through life, as we go through life, we have seen things in our own lives and people around us. And we have seen God move in those things and change people and remold people and make people different from what they were. It brings order out of disorder. It brings life, it gives life to what is lifeless. It gives authority to the depossessed. And above all, it gives grace to be called his children. And that grace of being called his children comes with, you know, you walk like the child of the king, and you do like that, and you walk and you let people know that I'm a child of the kingdom. And as you take step, the powers and the principalities of this world will be thinking, who is he? What does he think he is? And you reply, I am the child of the kingdom. I am the son of my father. And he has authority over all powers and dominion. That needs to be your mantras every day, every time, everywhere. But before we can do that, before we can be that person walking with swagger, yeah, the child of the kingdom is coming, the child, we need to live in obedience of him. For this to be, we need to be obedient to him and his calling. We need to acknowledge before him that we are formless, and let him take hold and remold us as he desires. You see, if God is going to be able to move, we need to submit to him. We need to let him remake us. We need to let him remold us. We need to let him use us in whatever way that he desires. We cannot dictate to God and expect that his grace will continue to abide with us. It's like one of my children telling me, you have to do this, Dad. I'll tell you what you have to do, daughter or son. So this morning, if you are here and you think you are not worthy, I have news for you. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26 says, I will give you a new heart and put new spirit in you. He will make you a new person. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh, a heart that he can walk with, a heart that you can walk with. you are a child of God and you know that you already have God's Spirit living in you and abiding with you and working in you, you need to start to take hold of that. Not to let the difficulties, not to let the things of this world hold you back from being what God wants you to be. And it may be that you are here this morning and you think, I am worthless. As he said in Ezekiel, he's ready, he's willing, he's prepared to give you a new heart. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 1, the Bible says, everyone who believes that Jesus is Christ is born of God. So if you are here this morning and you think you have come here with your idea of what God is, and you think, I want to share in that. I want to see. I want to move as God's child. I want to move as a child of God. I want to move as here to the kingdom of God. The Bible tells me something. It says, confess. 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 That if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That you are here this morning is not an accident. It's because God has ordained it. And he's ready and he's prepared to give you new life. He went to the cross so that Rotimi Awoniyi can be his child, walking as he ought to walk, a child of the kingdom, with that majestic walk. It is available to you. Again, the song we sang earlier on, there in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he arose and he stands in victory. Since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. That he died and he rose again is victory. He gives you the grace to become, to be partakers in the kingdom, to be his child. Don't let this opportunity pass you by. Because he's ready, he's willing, he's here, present this morning. He wants you to talk to him. He wants to listen to you. He wants you to become his child. He is prepared to take you out of that formless pit into and make you a beauty. And you can walk into his kingdom and people can see his beauty radiating you. This morning, he's here, he's present. He is here and he's present. And his power of forgiveness is still fresh today. Because every morning is renewed. He's present here today. Let him take hold of it. Let him take hold of you. And you see the change he will make in you. You see the change people will see in you. People will be passing by you and they'll stop and think. Because his grace is upon you. Because his grace is upon you. So, If we have that, it is right, therefore, to sing for joy to our God, to God our strength, to shout aloud to the God of Jacob, to begin music and strike tambourine, play the melodious harp, sound the ram's horn at the new moon. It is good. In my culture, when a child is born, on the seventh day, it's named. And when it's named, I tell you, there's always an almighty celebration. Dancing, all form of music instrument. And so it is. When you turn to Him, and when you accept Him as your Lord and Savior, there's dance, there's joy, there's happiness in heaven. And that's available for us. For those of us that are already in the kingdom, let's go dancing, let's go walking, let's continue walking like the children of the kingdom. Let people see God's power, see God's authority manifested in us and through us. And for those of us that are wanting to see that happen in our lives, it is time, it is this morning for you to let God's power move in you. Sing for joy. It doesn't matter that you think people will hate your voice. It doesn't matter that you think your partner will want to block her ears when you sing. You are not singing to them, you are singing to God. Sometimes when I sing, you see the look on Nola's face, and I... And I know that I'm singing out of tune, but God loves my singing anyway. When I dance, my children just laugh at me and think, you think you're dancing? But I'm dancing to God. I'm dancing for God. Let that be what we do in life. Let's live for God. Let's dance for God. Let's sing for God. And let's live our lives for God. Because you have been beautifully made. You have been wonderfully made. He knows you because He forms you. If He knows everything about you, then what excuse do you have? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your words that you have spoken to us this morning. We thank you because you have ministered to us. And Lord, as we come before the throne this morning, you know each and every one of us. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those of us that are just at the point of asking you to be their Lord and their Father, Father. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you continue to uphold them and you continue to minister to them. You continue to speak into their situations. And for those of us that already know you and stand in you, Father, we pray that by your Spirit we'll continue to stand firm in you, Lord. Let your glory shine in our lives. Let your power be radiated in our lives for your kingdom, Lord. Thank you for this beautiful day that you have created. It's a day that no one has been through before, but you know everything is in it. And I know, Father God, that it's a day of favor for your children. And as we start this week, it's a week of uncommon favor, of blessing and breakthroughs in people's lives, Lord. Father, we thank you. We thank you that your Spirit is alive and very, very potent. We glorify your holy name as we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.